give God praise for 1 year together. We thank you, God, for this 1 year that we have with you, God. Hallelujah. Hey. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are so happy and elated to have you all here with us celebrating our first year anniversary. Ain't God good? Isn't he amazing? We are so grateful to all of you who have helped Growth Point become what it is today. We are thankful to God for our pastor and our first lady and our assistant pastor. And at this time, we are going to introduce our special guest. Y'all know we like to, you know, do some things from time to time. And listen, when I tell y'all, we got a singer in here, a preacher. He gonna minister to y'all. So, ushers, y'all might want to have them prayer cloths ready. Okay? Because y'all might, I might be out here on the floor. Okay? So, with us today, we have Sunday Best Season 7 winner, Geoffrey. Nicknamed him the Black Pavarotti. That's funny. He has an extensive musical background, comes from a musical family, correct? And has been in ministry since the age of... for a long time, okay? For a very long time. We're just so happy to have Minister Geoffrey Golden here. He is going to minister to us. So at this time, stand to your feet and help give a Growth Point welcome to Minister Geoffrey Golden.
Woo, Jesus, hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Come on, keep it down. Y'all already got it. Come on, unto God.
Unto God.
Immortal and invisible.
Immortal and invisible.
The only wise God.
The only wise God.
Be honor and the glory.
Be honor and the glory.
Come on, hear me say, say. Unto God.
Unto God.
Yes, sir. He's immortal and invisible.
Immortal and invisible.
Hey, the only wise God.
The only wise God.
Ha, we give him all the
honor and the glory.
Come on. Unto you be honor.
Be honor.
And glory.
Forever and ever.
Unto you be honor
and glory
forever.
Woo. Forever and ever.
Hey, unto God.
Immortal and invisible.
He's the only wise God.
Wise God.
Hey. Come on, we give him all
the honor and the glory.
One more time unto God. My God is the only wise, the only true God. Yes, we give it all to Jesus.
Come
on. Unto you be honor
and glory
forever.
Father,
we give you
honor.
We give you glory. But unto your name be all the honor that we earn. Oh yeah. God, we give it to you.
Forever and ever.
Good God, we praise you.
We praise you,
Lord. Forever. Come on, come
on.
You've been so good, so we praise you.
We praise you.
Forever. Your faithfulness,
we
got to give you the glory.
Forever and ever.
God, you change not, and your compassion, they fail not.
Yes, ever.
Father, you're good,
we praise
and
you.
Your mercy
you.
Endure.
Forever and ever.
Hand up your kingdom,
we
there
you.
Shall be no
we
end. You shall reign.
Forever and ever.
Good God, we praise you.
We praise you.
We praise you.
We praise you.
Yes. air. We praise you.
We praise you.
We praise you.
We praise you.
You're mighty.
We praise you.
You're good.
We praise you.
Nobody like you.
We praise you.
Searched all over.
We praise
you. But there's nobody like you.
We praise you.
Lord, I look high.
We praise you.
Lord, I look low.
We praise you.
In the mountains.
We praise you.
In the valleys.
We praise you.
I look east.
We praise
and
you.
I looked west.
We praise
I looked in people.
We praise
I looked in stuff.
We praise
I looked in stuff.
We praise
but I found
we praise
there's nobody.
We praise
I found
we praise
there's nothing
we praise
like Jesus.
We praise you.
We praise,
we praise
you.
We praise you.
Hey. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All of my help. It's already gone.
That's all right.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Wonderful Jesus.
Comes from him. He is our maker, our savior, our provider, our redeemer. Celebrate him. Come on, all of my help. Hallelujah. It says, all of my help, all of my help, all of my help comes from you, my Savior. All of my help, all of my help, all of my help comes from you. It comes from you.
All of my help comes from you.
For you are the world.
You are the one that my heart is struck.
When I am
weak,
you renew my strength. So we say,
my help, all of my
it comes from you.
Comes from you.
All of my help, all of my help, all of my help comes from you, my Savior. All of my help, all of my help, all of my help comes from you. It comes from you.
All of my help comes from you.
Father, you are the one.
You are the
my heart is strong too. And
to
even when I'm weak, you renew my strength. So it's here.
My help,
all of my
help,
it comes from you.
Oh,
all of my help. Come on, can you sing it?
All
if you
of
have
my
it.
Help,
all
of my help comes from you,
yes.
My Savior.
All of my help.
All of my help.
Everything that I
all
long
of
for.
My help.
Everything that I
all
need.
All of my help comes from you.
Lord, it comes from
all
you.
All of my help comes from you.
Father, you are the only
you
one.
You are the one.
My heart is drawn to. And
to.
Even when I'm weak,
you renew.
So we say,
my help.
Your perfect peace as we keep our minds stayed on you. Father, you are our faith, our trust, our hope. We declare this with confidence. It says, you are my refuge and strength, a present help in the time of trouble. I look to the hills from whence cometh my help, for my help comes from you. Everybody say,
you are my refuge.
He's a very present help in the time of trouble.
In the time of trouble,
I look to the hills.
To the
there's a lot of stuff going on.
But
where does my help come
my
from?
Help comes from?
Father, you are my refuge.
You are my refuge.
I found you to be a very present
help
in the time of
in
trouble.
The time of trouble.
Yes,
yes,
it comes from
it
you.
Comes from
courage and strength. Jesus is reciting the Lord's Prayer. Well, he's not reciting it. He's giving it to us. It's a model prayer. To say the disciples pray. To like teach us how to pray. He's like, okay, cool. You know, Geoffrey, the National Virgin, teach us how to pray. Okay. He's like, okay, cool. I can do that. So, okay, our Father who is in heaven, he's teaching us how to pray. I love this, Pastor Mario. Can y'all give it up for my big brother, Pastor Mario Geoffrey? Jesus comes from heaven. And why does he come? Brother, you came from heaven to earth to show the way, right? Shows us the way of the kingdom. This is what life looks like when you're completely submitted to God and when you're in a relationship with him. So who better to teach us how to pray than he who is the Son of God, who is living eternal intimacy with the Father. He is one with the Father. He is God. And at the end of that prayer, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Forever. Amen. Because at the end of the day, it all belongs to you. Father, I've got needs down here, and I'm asking you to give me my daily bread, and God, I want you to forgive my sins and my trespasses, and God, I need you to help me forgive those who have trespassed against me. But God, when it's all said and done, yours is the kingdom. Let's give glory to the Lamb.
Word. So we're going to go to the Word real quick in my remaining time. We're going to go to Luke, the 17th chapter. You don't have to stand for it because you've been standing, but we're going to make our confession, though. You can go back up to that, make our confession. You can pull, download your Bible apps. Derica is here, and I honor Derica. Thank you for coming. If you download your Bible apps, your phone, and all that type of stuff, I say a whole bunch of people's names in the course of a message, so you don't even have to worry about who I'm talking to, because y'all be looking around like, who? Just, they know who it is. So download your Bible app, pull out your phone. If you grabbed it off of your grandmama's table today, just pull it out. Pull it out of your bag that you have. It's a really big Bible, got everybody's funeral program in it, but just open it up. And we're going to go ahead and we're going to read that today. Our confession. Everyone, lift up your Bibles, lift up your phones, lift up your iPads, your tablets, your Samsung Galaxies, whatever. Lift it up. Repeat after me. Say, this is God's word for my life. I read it, receive it, understand it, and love it. I'm so glad I have what I need to grow. We're going to go to Luke, the 17th chapter. Brenda, what's that? My white phone. Did I have that white phone down there? If I don't, just bring it up here. I had it out somewhere. But the Lord put me on the floor, and I lost all my context. Is it right there? I don't know what it is. It's a white phone, the one you had. All right, Luke, the 17th chapter, and beginning at verse 11. And it says, now it happened. Thank you, all you. Thank y'all for everything. Thank you, Tim. Thank you very much. Tim is a testimony. You don't understand that. Tim is a testimony. It was over a year ago. Exactly a year ago that something happened just dramatically, and he was in the trach. We didn't know if he was going to be here. You would go into the hospital. He couldn't talk. He couldn't even look at you because he was sedated, and they didn't know if he was going to make it out. But when he came out and went right back to the instrument that he was playing before he went in. And God has gotten the glory. He is a testimony. I want to acknowledge Pastor Josh Brown. Thank you for coming today from Remnant Community Church. Thank you for coming. There have been many, many pastors who have supported, and I appreciate it. I don't have the stories that a lot of people have. They say these things, you know, you ain't gonna get no support. I've had a lot of support from wonderful pastors, because when you realize that your assignment is not their assignment, and you have an assignment, you stick to your assignment. You don't have to compete with anybody, because your assignment is different than everybody else's assignment. But we have one mission, and it's to get everybody to Jesus. That's it. No matter what you call your church. McDonald's ain't mad about Wendy's. We have a lot of, that's church talk, where people start saying, what you think about? I don't know what I think about. God called them just like he called me. My daughter has a slang. She told me, my daughter keeps me hip. She told me, she said, Nike ain't concerned about Reebok. No, worried about it. Minister Thomas Jarber just came in. I want to thank him as well for coming as well for his ministry. Luke, the 17th chapter, beginning at verse 11, it says this, and it's on the screen for those who don't have a Bible. It says this, now it happened as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men, someone say 10 men, who were lepers, who stood afar off, and they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Verse 14 says, and so when he saw them, he said to them, go show yourselves to the priest. And so it was that as they went, they were cleansed. And verse 15 says, and one of them, when he saw that he was healed, he returned with a loud voice. He glorified God and fell down on his face and his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. Verse 17, so Jesus answered and said, were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Were there not anyone else who came returned to give God glory except this foreigner? And he said to him, arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well. One version says, whole. I want to talk about the power of one. I was thinking about as we're entering our first year anniversary, thank you, and I remember when Miles was 1 year old, and I remember the different things that I learned from Miles, and I remember my niece now is 6 months old, and I remember the different stages and different things that were going on then, and I remember, though, when he turned one, and how monumental that was. I mean, it's interesting. I don't know. I'm talking to mothers real quick. I don't know what it is to disconnect. Maybe I talk to fathers first. I think there's a disconnect between fathers and mothers, Sean, because a lot of times in mothers and fathers, when you ask the mother how old the child is, the mother says, you know, 24 months. They say 14 months, 16 months. It's my child is 12 months and 3 days and 4 hours and 3 seconds. When it comes to the father, 3 months. He's a year, year and a half, 2 years, because you don't keep up with all that stuff. But it seems to mean something to the mom because the mom carried him longer than this dad, than the dad did. So when the child was birthed, it was really something monumental. So they remember the months, the seconds, what time, and all that type of stuff. But I learned some things when it came to the first year of the child. There were some certain milestones that happen when you turn one. And I want to talk about some of those milestones that happen when you turn one. First, it's the growth of the child. The child's baby weight has tripled, and the brain is about 60% of its adult size. Another thing about 1 year old is that they have motor skills, and this is talking about growth point two. They had motor skills were better. They were able to start standing alone. They were able to start making solo steps. They start able to do some things on their own, like eating with their fingers, helping their parents dress them, and turning pages in the storybook. There are some of you, when you first came here, you weren't able to stand on your own. You weren't able to pray on your own. You weren't able to, you needed someone to check on you. You needed someone to find you. I think I saw Juanita here earlier. I don't know where she is, but I think I did. Hey, Juanita, we missed you a whole lot, but you're still here on your first anniversary. That's all that matters. You are here. When you're 1 year old, your motor skills and standing alone, and for some people, that doesn't make any sense to you, or you don't appreciate standing on your own until you had to depend on somebody else to help you stand. It doesn't mean anything to you for you to have your own job, your own business, your own car, until you had to wait on somebody else to pick you up. Doesn't mean anything to you about having your own until you have to wait on somebody. And it's interesting because there are some people who will do things for you, but then they'll remind you that they did it. There are some people who will pray for you, and then when you come out, they'll say, well, it's only because I prayed for them. There are some people who will give you a job and they will put in a good word for you, but you owe them the whole time you work in there. And then they'll say that I put the word in for them. That's why they got it anyway. So you don't really understand what it means to stand on your own until you had to crawl through hoops and you had to go through different people because your credit score wasn't good. You needed a cosigner. But when you were able to go on the lot and say, I don't need no cosigner. My credit's good. I've been working on it for a long time. I've been paying off bills. It took me a long time to get here. I rode a hoopy, rode my grandmama's car, but now I'm riding nice. Not that I think I'm better than anybody else, but I went through, so now I can appreciate what it means to stand on my own. Is there anybody who can appreciate that in the room? I can't tell you what it means, and I can't tell you what it was like when I had to depend on somebody else because I wasn't praying for myself. I didn't believe myself, so I had to have somebody else to believe for me. So the motor skills of a child is able to stand on their own, and then they're able, and then another thing it says, their sleep starts to be regulated. They're able to sleep more at night than in the day. And there are some people that God is shifting you from sleep in the day to sleep at night because you've been worrying about too much stuff and you've been staying up too long. And God's saying it's time for you to go to sleep and let me worry about it. God is a refuge and strength. He is a very present help in the time of trouble. It's time for you to go to sleep now. It's time for you to stop waking up tired and coming to the church saying, I'm just going through. It's time for you to say that though he slay me, I still trust him. I'm learning how to go to sleep. When you turn one, you learn how to go to sleep and stop worrying about stuff and stop causing. That's telling people you didn't put your makeup on today. That's why you look like that. You need to go ahead and go to sleep. sleep so you can get all the beauty rest you need. Someone say, go to sleep, go to sleep. Say it again, go to sleep. Then your eating begins to change when you're 1 year old. When you're 1 year old, you begin to get off of breast milk and you're able to start eating more solid food. You don't need to depend and latch on to people as much as you used to, because see, my niece is 6 months old and she can't feed herself. So she needs my sister to feed her. So every time she's whining and she's crying, she might not know exactly what she needs, but as soon as she latches on, she says, that's what I was looking for. And there are some of you, when you were 6 months and 5 months and 7 months and 8 months, you needed something to latch on to because you didn't know exactly what you needed. But somebody had the nourishment for you. Somebody had the prayer for you. Someone had the interceding for you. Someone had the fasting for you. And when they latched on to you, you were saying, that's exactly what I needed. But when you become one, you're able to say, thank you for that, but I don't need it as much anymore. Now I'm able to eat peas. Now I'm able, they might be smushed up, but they are giving me what I need. I'm able to eat carrots. I know they might be smushed up and in a jar, but at least I can eat it now. Don't you ever despise growth. Don't you ever cause anybody to make you feel bad about the stages that you're going through to get what God will have for you to be. If you haven't been a praiser yet, keep pushing until praise gets on your mouth. If you've never danced before, keep hopping around until you start getting a rhythm. I tell you, when I first started dancing, I scuffed up all of my shoes. I didn't know what I was doing. All of my shoes were a ratchet mess. But eventually, a little two-step, I was like, okay, okay. Hey, a dip will come on. Ooh, then a twirl. I was like, woo. You just keep on practicing until you get it. Tell somebody, keep on practicing. I'm not talking about your dance. I'm talking about keep reading until you learn it. Keep praying until it becomes fluent. Keep seeking the Lord until you find him. Keep falling on your face before you feel something. Pray and keep hollering before you until you hear him. He called. Call on him while he's near. Tell someone, call him. Keep on saying Jesus till you feel something. Say Jesus until demons flee. Say Jesus until your husband comes to you to growth point. Say Jesus until you get a job. Say Jesus until the person who fired you calls you back and say, we made a mistake. Call Jesus. Shut up. Call him while he's near. Be afraid to call on the name of Jesus. For the name of the Lord is a strong tower. Where the righteous run therein and say, I've called on the Lord and he heard me and he delivered me out of all my fears. I love the Lord because he heard my cry and he pitied my every groan. Long as I live and trouble rise, I'll hasten. I love the Lord. He heard my cry. Tell somebody, I love him because he loves me. I love him. When I called him, he answered me. When I loved him, I was, when I called him, I was in drugs, but he called me. When I was in the bar stool, but he called his name and he called. He sent somebody to me. I was sitting there slipping on. I was sipping on something. I was drinking something, but I called him. And somebody said, baby, there's a better way. I called him and he heard me. I'm able to call Jesus. At 6 months, you don't know how to call daddy. 7 months, you don't know how to call mama. You just know they're taking care of you, but you don't know what to call them. But when you turn 1 month, when you turn 1 year old, you start saying, da, da. You start saying, mama. And there's some of you, when you turn one, something's going to come out of your mouth. Hallelujah. 1 year old, you're going to start, glory. 1 year old, thank you, Jesus. And all of a sudden, it's going to feel good. You'll be like, thank you, Jesus. And the more you say it, the better you feel. And the better you feel, the more you say it. And the more you say it, the better you feel. You'll be depressed, but you'll be like, thank you, Jesus. And they'll tell you, you need pills, but you're like, thank you, Jesus. And they'll come back and they'll say, what happened to the pills? It wasn't the pills. It was a thank you, Jesus. It wasn't an Eastern State Hospital. It was a thank you, Jesus. It wasn't a Charter Ridge. It was a thank you, Jesus. When I came into Growth Point, didn't know what it meant. I didn't even know what Shata, Wobo, Shikataba. Didn't know what it meant, but I lifted up my hands 1 o'clock service on a Sunday, and I said, thank you, Jesus, for about 30 seconds. And all of a sudden, my Jesus turned to Ikataba. Thank you, Jesus. When I turn 1 year old, it starts to make me feel better. Somebody clap your hands in the room. Ibashi. Thank you, Jesus. I began to start My communications get better when I'm in 1 year old. My vocabulary starts to expand. Then you have to be careful because when you turn 1 year old, you have to be careful, Geoffrey, because your social skills start to develop. And you have to be careful, Doug, because you start to prefer certain people over others. Because when you're 1 year old, you start to recognize who you like and who you don't like. So certain family members come in, they be like, hey, boo-boo kitty. They be like, you ain't Lucius. They get upset. They get upset and they don't like you. They don't want to be around you. You have to be careful because there's something when you start being one, something's a word. It's a prophetic word. It's a Greek Hebrew word, Thomas. And I know your research of the word is a word. You'll find it in Mario chapter 5, verse 3. And it's a word. It's called clicks.
You better talk about it.
When you become 1 year old, you start to recognize who you want to be around and who you don't want to be around. Because you prefer some others. You prefer some more than others. You have to be very careful when you become one. Because while you're excited about your development, you have to be careful that you don't forget about the people who were there for you before you knew who they were. Before you knew you needed them. Don't get to where you don't need them anymore. You have to be careful when you start preferring people over other people. I like him more than I like her, and I sit on this side of the room because they shout too much. You have to be very, very careful of avoiding cliques. Look at someone and say, avoid it, avoid it, avoid it, avoid it. Why y'all not shouting like you were a few minutes ago? Why y'all not shouting like you were? A lot of y'all shouting, I said, Jesus, yeah! Talk about cliques. I hear them. It's very important as we move forward that you don't get to the point that you only like certain people. Yeah. All of us have people in the family that we don't necessarily like to be around, but they're still family. Yeah. And you have to learn how to adjust because you have to be careful not liking something in somebody else that's really only reminding you of something in yourself that you don't like. So a lot of your discontentment with somebody else is really a discontentment in yourself. You blame it on Uncle John, but it was really something going on in the Uncle John down inside of you that wakes up around 12 o'clock and you turn from a Mogwai to a gremlin. You have to be very careful that you don't start saying what you don't like in somebody else when there's really something inside of you. Then the next thing is, the next thing that you have to find out about when you turn 1 year old is that it's the time that babies start to get shoes. And the thing about them getting shoes is you have to be careful that you don't just look for the cute shoes. Because a lot of people only want, I want to get them the Jordans. I want to make sure they got the latest stuff. Well, they might not be ready to walk in that just yet. Rhonda, it might not look nice. It might not look appealing, but it's firm. You need something firm before you need something that looks nice. When you build a foundation on a house, it doesn't look nice and it looks real messy. But the foundation is more important than the shutters. The foundation is more important than the flat screen. The foundation is more important than the carpet. The foundation is more important than the windows. The foundation, and some of you want cute, you don't want foundation. And if you really want to grow, if you really want to be something in God, you need a firm foundation. You don't need to be cute. Forget about what you wear in the church. It don't matter right now. Do you have a foundation of prayer? Do you have a foundation of belief? Where is your faith? You sitting there outside and Vanessa saying, Master, the tempest is raising. You need to be able to say, peace be still in the midst of what you're going on. You don't need somebody else to say peace to you. You need to have a foundation that you can speak peace to everything that's coming in your house and in your life. Give God a praise in the house. You need a foundation. Shoes didn't look nice. I remember when Miles first got his shoes. I thought they were gunky and white. Why do all first shoes have to be white? They were white and they were hard. But when he was trying to learn how to balance, He needed something hard to stand on. Come on, hymn writer, on Christ, the solid rock I stand. He needed something firm. He needed something strong to stand on. Some of you are trying to stand on mushy people. Trying to stand on mushy relationships. And you got people you connected with that you can't depend on. You need to make a transfer. You need to stop standing on mushy people and seasonal people. You need something firm to stand on. That's why he said to him, he said, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. For flesh and blood, and now I feel like preaching in the room today, flesh and blood did not reveal that to you. You need something firm that the gates of hell cannot prevail against. It doesn't mean you don't get laid off. Doesn't mean you don't go through, but you got something firm to stand on. When they walk out the door, say, walk out all you want to. When I get back, I'm calling on Jesus. I don't care what you say about me. I'm going to keep calling on Jesus. But you need something firm to stand on in order to get to that point. You don't need another church. You need something firm. I don't like the pews. I don't like the air. You don't need that. You need something firm to stand on. Some of you think I got away from my text. I know exactly where I am. Someone say, he knows where he is. Y'all sitting there looking at the Bible like, he ain't said nothing about the lepers. I've been talking about your leprosy the whole time. Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem. While Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem, he stopped in between Samaritan and Galilee. He stopped on the way. Jesus was on his way to his assignment, Shekel. He was on his way to his assignment. And while he was on his way to his assignment, Sister Bridget, was the cross. And while he was on his way to his assignment, he stopped in Galilee and Samaria. While he was on his way to his assignment, which was the cross, while he was on his way to go up the Via Dolorosa, while he was up on the cross, while he was going to the cross, while he was headed to his assignment, while he was headed to be bruised, while he was headed to be whipped, while he was headed to be shamed, he stopped in the midst of him going through his assignment to be able to help somebody else. I want to know, is your assignment more important than somebody else? Are you so focused on what you got to do, and so focused on your next job, and so focused on your breakthrough, and so focused on the stuff God promised you, because he's not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent? Are you so focused on your promise and so focused on your prophecy that you can't stop to help somebody? Jesus had his assignment in view, had nowhere he was going, but he stopped in between Galilee and Samaria, and he saw 10 lepers. When he saw the lepers, because I'm almost finished, when he saw the lepers, he saw the lepers standing afar off. Because according to Leviticus, when you have leprosy, you cannot stand in close proximity to people. You have to stand afar off. And everywhere they went, they had to cry these words and say, unclean! Unclean! Don't come near me because I'm unclean! Unclean! Everywhere they went, they were not known by name. They were known by unclean! Everywhere they went, they were not known by who they were associated with. They were not known by their family. They were known by their issue. Have you ever walked in any room and before you opened your mouth, they knew you by what you were associated with? Before you got to a church, somebody, other pastor, had already called the new pastor and told them about you before you got to the new church. So you didn't have a new chance because they already tried to talk about you before you got there. So when you come up to the church, they say, unclean. Unclean. So everywhere he went, and when he walked, everywhere the lepers went, they had a cry, unclean. And a cry, unclean, because no one could associate with them. No one could be in close proximity with them. No one could have relationship with them. So when Jesus came and stopped his mission, and when Jesus stopped and he looked at them, all of a sudden, Jesus stopped and they said to him, Lord, have mercy on me. Come on now. They didn't say, come heal me. They didn't say, lay hands on me. They said, have mercy on me. You don't know what it's like to live in constant pain. You don't know what it's like to live in constant struggle. So when they saw Jesus and heard about him, they said, have mercy on us. Whatever you can do to help us, you don't have to heal me, but help me. And there's some of you who came to Growth Point and you came through the door saying, have mercy.
I don't want to join the choir. I just want mercy. I don't want to preach no more. I just want mercy. I don't want to work the altar call. I just want mercy. I don't want anybody to lay hands on me. I just want mercy. I don't want to play the keyboard. I just want mercy.
Some of you came in just wanting mercy. Not a position, just mercy. Not a title, just mercy. Jesus looked at them and he said, he didn't even respond to them. He looked at them, he responded to them according to their issue. He looked at them and he said, go show yourselves to the priest. Because according to Leviticus, any time that there was something that was going on, if you, according, it had to be atonement, it had to be blood, and had all these things shed, and all this stuff. He said, I want you to show yourself to the priest and let them declare you free. Let them declare you whole. Let them declare you healed. All that stuff. So he went. And then it says after that, he says, as they went, while they were moving, they got healed. Say that again. He said, go show yourselves to the priest. And it says, as they went, they got healed. He said, go show yourselves to the priest. And, you know, Geoffrey, you study a whole lot more than me, so I might be really wrong. So I want you to tell me if I'm wrong. If you can, you can come back up here and see Glory to the Lamb part two. But it says that he said, go show yourselves to the priest. And he says, go show yourself to the priest. He says, as they went, they got healed. Did not say, someone said, come do an altar call, then you get healed. No one said, let me give you a word, then you get healed. No one said, fast for 7 days, you get healed. No one said, go to the Church of God in Jesus' name only, church, and then you'll get healed. No one says, go back in the water and you get healed. No one says, put anything on top of your head and then you get healed. No one said anything. They just said, go show yourselves to the priest. When you show yourselves to the priest, it says, as they went, they got healed. The thing that confuses me about this, Thomas, is that there are a whole bunch of people who need to be healed, but they won't move. It says in a few verses before, Geoffrey, tell me if I'm wrong. Tia, you tell me if I'm wrong. You my new friend. You were dancing last night. You my new friend. So you told me, it says in the scripture. Y'all tell me if I'm wrong. Y'all got your Bibles open. Y'all tell me, I'm in the Bible. I'm not out of it. It says a few verses before, they said, have mercy. Come on now. So that meant they said, Nautica, I got an issue. Jesus said, go show yourself to the priest. And it says, as they went. My concern, Tashay, is that how are you going to keep coming to church and say you got issues, but you won't do nothing? I got a drinking problem. Have you got help? I got anger management issues. Have you got help? I can't stay out of the bed. Have you... I'm going to be real nice today. All this stuff you say you need help with, but have you done anything? Me and my wife are having problems. Me and my family's having problems. Have you got counseling? No, I just need a word. Counseling was the word. I ain't weak. You're not weak. You're actually strong because you actually identify that you need something beyond a bump. You need something beyond a Rosh HaTabah. You need something. Sometimes the tongue ain't it. You need something. You need to sit on somebody's couch and say, my name is, and it's been 6 months since I made my last confession. And can you help me? Because I got a problem. You need to lower yourself and say, I need help. You're not weak, you're strong. Yeah. Sometimes some of you need counseling from church. No. Some of you thought I said you need counseling in the church. No, baby. I said you need counseling from the church. Some of the stuff that's wrong with you happened in the church. And you need somebody to talk to you about what happened in the church. The problem is you keep going to the pastor for counseling and he messed you up. I'm not knocking on anybody else. I'm talking about growth points. It's our anniversary. I'm talking about you. Some of that messed you up because the pastor went from counseling, found out what you needed, and then tried to give you what you needed. And that would happen to the sons of Eli.
The sons of Eli went from stealing money in the temple. I'm in the Bible. Went from stealing money in the temple and start sleeping with the women in the temple. And he went to his daddy, and the prophet went to his daddy and said, are you going to address that stuff in the house? And he wouldn't address that stuff in the house. And because he didn't address that stuff in the house, it said that the glory left the temple. And there are a whole bunch of churches having a whole bunch of packed people, but the glory has left the temple. That's why when Geoffrey walked off the stage, he walked off the stage because the glory had hit the temple. And I don't want to preach without glory. I don't want to sing without glory. I don't want to preach without glory. I don't want to play with God's glory. You got to have his glory. I don't have to be the best preacher, but I got to have his glory. I don't have to be on the Word Network, but I got to have his glory. I don't have to be on TBN, but I have to have his glory. I don't have to meet Kirk Franklin, but I got to have his glory. Because when I see Jesus, all of my trials, all of my situations will be over. You don't have to invite me to preach, but let me have his glory. I need his glory. You can't have his glory and your issues at the same time. There shall have no other God before him. You got to lay down your issues and pick up his glory. You got to lay down your stuff that you're struggling with and pick up his glory. Some of you can't praise God because you got too much on you. You need to take off what's on you and pick up his glory. You need to take off what's trying to weigh you down, shackled by a heavy burden, beneath the load of guilt and shame. Then the hand of Jesus touched me, and I'm no longer the same. He touched me. Somebody needs a touch in the room. Someone say, touch me, God. I need his glory. I need his glory. So they said, as they went, they got healed. If you want something, you got to do something. It may not be a lot, but do something. It might not, it just might be small increments, but do something. Delete somebody's number out your phone. Let that be the start. Then after you delete it, put them on block so they can't even contact you no more. Do what you gotta do. If you know he's your weakness, come on TLC, my weakness is me. Whatever your weakness is, put them on block so they can't get access to you. Stop chasing waterfalls. You need something that will stop the things that are trying to fall in your life. You need to stand on the promises of God. Someone say, stop chasing it. I feel like preaching in the room. It's my anniversary, and I preach if I want to. You need. They went. They got healed. In the midst of that, and I'm finished here. At the midst of that, it says that while they got healed, while they were going, while they were moving, it says one said. He saw he was healed. How did he see it? Because to have leprosy is an outward manifestation of what's going on in the inside, Tiffany. And there's some of you who have an outward sickness that everybody sees, and everybody knows your name, everybody knows your issue. And when he saw that the thing he had been complaining about wasn't on him anymore, he said, I got to turn around. And he went back to give him thanks. There are some people, and the reason that I'm like this today, and the reason I am cranked today, is because sometimes you talk, you preach about, you sing about, and you dance about your issues. I've had some good days. I've had some hills to climb. I've had some weary days. And some sleepless nights. All of that stuff is your problem. Sometimes my clouds hang low, so low. I can hardly see the road. All that stuff is making you sad and depressed. But what happens when he takes away the stuff you're complaining about? What happens when you're still singing a song that you can't even relate to anymore? What happens when you still trying to complain, but you can't because it ain't nothing there to complain about? He removed your torch. He removed your story. He removed what you were complaining about. He removed your issue, and you still trying to hold on to something that he's already removed. When he saw that he was healed, when he saw that he was cleansed, he turned around. Walk back to Jesus. We used to be able to complain about a whole bunch of stuff, but what happens when he removes what you're complaining about? So in the midst of that, he walked, and my time is up. He walked and he turned around and he went back to give thanks to Jesus, and Jesus responded to him, and he said, were there not other people? Because there were a whole bunch of people who were crying mercy. There were a lot of other people who had issues. Did nobody else turn around to say anything? He said, you know what? Because you turned around, because you came back, he said, your faith has made you. Didn't say, now this version says, well. One version says it's made you whole. What I'm saying is, on our anniversary, there's a whole bunch of people in here that came in here with issues. And there are a lot of you who got healed and got whole. But how many of you have turned around to give him thanks? See, what happens is, and this is really important for us to know in the first year, because when we first started the church, we had 30 people. 35, 40, 50, 17. We had all those numbers all the time. We didn't want to post that. Because everybody wants to post the glory. We sold out our gala. We had standing room only. But can you show how you believe for the seats to be filled before they were filled? Can you post about how people were walking around praying? We were fasting for 21 days before people even knew what fasting was about. I know that we're giving God thanks for the full house for 2 weeks, but have you thanked God when we didn't know if we were going to have a house? Can you thank God when we were in the library? Can you thank God when we were setting up and pulling up screens and we had people walking around and we were paying to park in somebody else's garage? Can you thank God for that? I know some of y'all don't even know what I'm talking about. Can you thank God for the meetings that we used to have at Claudia's house where we used to eat Indy's chicken every Sunday because we were sitting here planning and we were praying and we were preparing for people we didn't even know what they were coming from. We were calling the Bible study my growth and people didn't even know what my growth was. We weren't talking about somebody's new growth on their hair. We were talking about Bible study and we were talking about my growth and people said, what is that? And we got t-shirts for people we didn't even know were coming. We were bleeding and leading at the same time. Wounded and helping somebody else at the same time. Confused but giving somebody else direction at the same time. We were going through ourselves wanting somebody to pray for us but praying for other people at the same time. And the more we thought, and the more I didn't have no organ back then, but I feel like I need something right now. So while I was down there in the library, y'all excuse me because I feel real Baptist real quick. So while I was down in the library and I was down there by myself and my wife was looking at me the same way she's looking at me right now because she don't like it when I get crunk like this. But you don't know my story. You don't know where I came from. And you don't know how I thought I wasn't going to make it. I thought I was going to stop preaching. I thought I was going to stop giving up. I thought I wasn't going back to church anymore. When I came back, Geoffrey, I was borderline depressed. I was borderline giving up. Still saved. Still speaking in tongues. But borderline depressed. Staying in my sister's house. All we had was two twin beds, and we were sitting there with my sons on one bed and my wife on another bed. Talk about no intimacy. But we were still believing in the midst of sharing space. We were sharing space, but still believing in the promises of God. So while we were running and jogging every single morning, while I was running and while I was jogging, I was still believing and I was still praying for people. And while we were praying, we went to the library and people kept coming. We didn't have no praise team, but I had the word. We didn't didn't have no organ, but I had the word. We didn't have a lot of people, but I had the word. We only had to set up chairs, but I had the word. We were taking pictures back then on a camera phone, posting it like we had bought the camera. I was messing with the pixels to make it a little bit better, but I had the word. Tell somebody, I had the word. God, excuse me, I won't preach like this next year, but since it's my anniversary, I'll do whatever I want to do because it's my anniversary. Tell somebody it's my anniversary. Look at somebody and say it's my party. So I didn't have a lot, but I had the word. Car repossessed, but I had the word. Mel didn't have a job, but we had the word. I didn't have a job, but I had the word. Tried to get food stamps. They said we couldn't get them. I don't know why, but I still had the word. Everybody was asking me, what's your next move? I said, thy word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against God. Everybody was looking at me from Mississippi. M-I, crooked letter I, crooked letter I, humpback, humpback I. Everybody was wondering what's going to come of Mario. I heard a long word about it. They said, I heard a lot of things about him. I wonder if it's true. And I felt like going on Facebook and telling everybody that what you heard is a lie. But God said, hold your mouth. Don't say nothing. I'll vindicate you in time. And I want to say a year later, if God be for me, who can be against me? What can separate me from the love of Christ? Shall death, shall persecution, nay, in all these things, we are conquerors. Tell somebody I'm a conqueror. I feel like preaching. I feel like Noel Jones. Tell somebody I'm more than a conqueror. So I was the one who was like the lepers. I had a whole lot of stuff on me. Everywhere I went, everybody knew my issue. But in the midst of counseling, all of a sudden, I was sitting on the couch one day. I was sitting there talking to my counselor. And all of a sudden, I realized that what I need counseling about, I didn't need it no more. Because I had a Bible study now. I had a church now, and the story I used to have, I can't talk about that no more, because in the midst of me going, in the midst of me preaching, in the midst of me singing, in the midst of me shouting, it started coming off of me. Layer by layer, I used to shout heavy, but now I shout free. I used to lift my hands heavy, but now I lift my hands free. I used to preach with a lapel 2 weeks ago, but 2 weeks later, I feel like cranking it because God has done great things. I look back and I wonder how I made it over. I look back and I wonder, how did I make it through? Someone say, to God be the glory. I praised for my own story, but can you praise for your own story? Can you have a flashback sitting on your row, thinking about where you used to be, thinking about how you didn't think you were going to come out, but look where, where the Lord has brought me from. Shante, you don't know how glad I am He saved my soul from hell. Thought I was going to be depressed. Thought my marriage was going to make it. Didn't think we were going to come out. But look at my wife. Casket sharp, up in Growth Point, walking with a good heel. So you didn't think we were going to make it. But look, Periscope, we still together. We still here. We're still here. Look at the devil and say, I'm still here. I'm still here after all I've been through. I'm still here. I cried, but I'm still here. I fell down, but I'm still here. I stumbled, but I'm still here. I gotta still hear praise. I gotta still hear praise. I gotta still hear praise. Glory. Happy anniversary!
I made it. You know, I'm touching about three people. I feel like being TJ for a second. Touch three people and say, I made it. They don't have to know what you made it out of, but tell them I made it. And when you get to third person, give them the best shout you can give them. After about third person, say, excuse me, that was for the Father, that was for the Son, and that was for the Holy Ghost. I think there's a fourth person. His name is Jesus, the soon coming King. Jesus, Mary's baby. Jesus, the stone that the builders rejected. Give him a Jesus praise. I made it. I made it. For every mountain, for every valley, for this I give you praise. For this I give you praise. I made it. But you got out in the parking lot and you met your destiny. Now your children are here. Your sister's here. Everybody's saved. You made it. You made it. Still strong, still pressing.
little Trisha in the room. It's a survivor's praise. This is a survivor's praise. This is a survivor's praise. This is a survivor's praise. I survived it. 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 Survived it. I survived it. I survived it. I survived it. I don't look like, I don't look like what I've been through. I don't look like what I've been through. I don't look like what I've been through. Give God the best praise in the room you can give him. Give him a shout. It's a survivor shell. 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 It's a shout with no music. It's a shout with no drums. It's a survivor shell. I made it. I might look a mess, but I made it. I might still not know how to dress, but at least I made it. I might not know how to put the scriptures together, but I still, at least I made it. At least I made it. At least I'm here. Whole bunch of people's funeral I went to, they're my friends, but I'm still here. I done looked into a lot of caskets of other people who OD'd and other people who became suicidal, but I'm still here. I ain't 15 years old yet, but at least I'm one. I'm here. I'm one. I'm here. I'm one of the ones that turn back to say thank you. I'm one of the ones. I saw when it came off of me, and I had to say thank you. Someone told me I did counseling. I didn't think it was going to work, but I'm one of the ones to turn back and say, thank you. Thank you for helping me. Thank you for putting me back together again. All the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't do it, but somebody took me to the King of Kings. Put me back together piece by piece. So this praise I have now is called a warrior's praise. It's a tried praise. It ain't the one I saw. It ain't the one on Bobby Jones. It's a warrior's praise. You had to fight to get this one. You had to go through to get this one. You had to lose to get this one. I got it. I got it.